which agency is monitoring pogo compounds in the country, and I mean legal pogos? Are agencies allowed in to go in any time? Are you allowed to inspect? Are you allowed to speak to the employees who are foreigners? Or do you need a court order or a warrant?
No. The frontliners in this fight would be PAGCOR. But remember, nothing precludes us, the Commission, nor the PNP and the NBI to get into a compound with a valid license from PAGCOR. If any of this IGL refuses inspection, motu proprio inspections, then that is a red flag. That would immediately initiate an operation against them. No?
Okay.
So yes.
Why haven't you inspected Island Cove? I mean, you have senators and even Representative Barber asking that. Island Cove is 13 hectares.
Yes, it is.
So you have some critics saying there's favoritism. It's being it's being favored in the sense because of we know the sale, right? Of Island Cove, it used to be owned by the family of the Justice Secretary. You have people, you have critics asking, why don't you treat it like any other? Why don't you investigate and check?
Okay, now as to checking, it is regularly checked first by PAGCOR. Again, I could not divulge the operational aspects of how we monitor all of these IGLs. But again, rest assured, without compromising the lives of the people monitoring, Island Cove, together with the 42 other IGLs, are closely monitored by the Commission. And until such time, and when the time comes that we're able to gain or receive actual intelligence that there are illegal activities happening inside from our intelligence sources, we would apply for a warrant. But as of this time, we have yet to receive anything concrete on Island Cove. It would be unfair to say that we are favoring Island Cove. No, no. We always look at them on a fair basis, no? All of them are legitimate and all of them are being closely monitored by the Commission. And once we get something, once we have the goods on them, I'm not saying that they are doing illegal activities inside, but once we get evidence that they're doing anything stupid, we'll apply for a warrant, regardless of who used to own Island Cove.
All right. Now, out of 43 POGO compounds or businesses in the Philippines that were granted licenses by PAGCOR, how many are of the size of Bamban, 7 hectares, PAGCOR, Porak, 10 hectares, Island Cove, 13 hectares? Are there other compounds of this size in the Philippines?
The biggest would be Island Cove. We've seen other compounds, no, not compounds, but other buildings that would approximate probably a hectare or a half a hectare.
Okay, but so where are they? Can you tell us where they are? I mean, are they in Makati, in Pasay? Where are they?
The 42 are all over Metro Manila, and the 43rd will be Island Cove. Island Cove is the last remaining compound of that size. The rest are, well, a good number are in Makati, Pasay, Parañaque, Las Piñas, Quezon City. Quezon City, not that many, but the bulk are congregating in the southern part of Metro Manila.
Mm-mm. Which is Pasay or Parañaque?
Pasay, Makati, Parañaque.
Okay. Now, let's talk about the raid in Fontana. Were you at the raid or only the Bureau of Immigration participated?
We were there. We helped Clark Development Corporation manage the operation. That was basically a CDC-initiated operation with the help of the Immigration and PAO.
So you only found three POGO personnel in Fontana?
Karen, there were two operations that happened in Puntana. The first one was last Thursday. That was coordinated by PAOC, the PNP CIDG, and the Club Development Corporation. Initially, we found 20 foreign nationals, but the 19 were able to present their documents, so we had to let them go. The 20th, on the other hand, failed to present his document, so he was detained. He is here inside our facility. The following day, Friday, the Clark Development Corporation and the Bureau of Immigration, through a mission order issued by the Commissioner of Immigration, went into the villas of Puntana, and they were able to find three of the fugitives that were able to escape from Bambat. So thankfully, they were able to do that, and they brought them here. And they've been inquested already, and during investigation, we have confirmed that these three are connected to Wang Jiang, or the escape, the fugitive big boss of Sun Yuan or Bambat.
Okay, so Winston, this means that is there enough evidence to show that the three are actually employees or officials of the Pogo Hub in Porac?
Yes, ma'am. We've got enough testimonial evidence and documentary evidence that would point to at least two of the three. Then again, they all failed to present valid documents. All of them have been inquested for immigration violations. But we'd have to conduct further analysis and further investigation, interview, so to speak, to be able to file additional criminal charges against them.
Okay. Now, would you know exactly what positions they held?
Okay. One was obviously a finance officer, because a good number of the properties of Wang Ziyang are in his name. And we have seen his name in some of the documents that we have gotten from the two major scum hubs that we raided, Bamban and Porac. So they're fairly high. They're fairly high in the food chain, so to speak.
Okay. Now, when we last spoke, you said that there are over 1,000 employees at the Porac hub, correct?
Correct.
And how many so far are still missing?
A good number of them, Karen. At any given time, it would have been no less than 1,000 to probably 2,500, because they were able to find more than 2,500 desktops, functioning desktops in Porac. So it could be that high. We only got, remember, 161. A good number of them were able to escape due to the leak that we suspect that basically stalled our operations last June 4 and June 7.
Is there any kind of record? This is what's baffling. You have, let's say, 1,000 to 2,000 people working in a hub, in a major, I would have to say, in a major province in the Philippines.
Yes.
Are there records of employees, foreign nationals, who were working there? Does the BI have records? Does PAGCOR have records?
Now, we'd have to talk to these agencies, of course, because one, as far as the Department of Labor is concerned, Lucky South only declared 100 or a little over 100 employees. Now, as far as PAGCOR is concerned, I'm not quite sure if it was 300 or 800. I can't recall the right number. As far as BI is concerned, I'm not quite sure if they've got a record of the foreign nationals working inside Lucky South 92.
Because clearly somebody isn't doing their job. Because if we're talking about, I would have to say, more than 1,000 foreign nationals, mostly of Chinese ethnicity, coming from mainland China, who are working in a gambling hub, and only 300 are registered, it doesn't add up. Who isn't doing their job?
Well, as I said, first of all, PAGCOR needs to have a list of all of their employees. Why? Because all employees working inside IGLs or the former POGOs needs to have an online gaming employee license.
Okay. Yeah, no? But clearly they don't have a list. They don't have a list of everyone.
Yes, they do have a list, but not of everyone. So I think there is, Pagcor has a lot of explaining to do in relation to that OGEL course. I've been saying this, and we've been saying this in different public fora. We're friends with Pagcor, but then again, they have too much in their hands. I don't think they're able to fully regulate or properly regulate even these 43 licensed IGLs. They need to do more. They need to do more. And of course, they need to properly coordinate the Bureau of Immigration. These two agencies obviously don't talk a lot, obviously. Because the records do not match up. They don't. The records don't add up.
Okay. Well, the need to do more is a bit of an understatement. In these POGO hubs, what have you discovered? Prostitution, torture. What else have you discovered? Crypto scams, shopping scams, love scams, right?
Yeah. Yes, yes. A good number of organized criminal activities are linked to this online gaming, offshore gaming operation. So at some point, all of us have to sit in one room and come up with an executive policy that we could recommend as one body to the chief executive.
Okay, sir, the last time I spoke with you, you already said you should sit in one room and dialogue. That must have been, I think, last week. You haven't sat in one room yet?
Obviously not yet. No. We've been having meetings left and right. No, but at the end of the day, we don't seem to agree on a single recommendation. Personally, I've sat in a good number of meetings, and we have yet to come up with one policy recommendation that we fully agree on and bring before the president and bring before the executive secretary, so to speak. So this question needs to be settled fairly soon, because our people are waiting for an answer as to what we would do what the executive branch would do in relation to this problem.
Yeah. Okay, I guess my last question, sir, is no doubt it's the PAOK that's been taking the lead. It's the PAOK that's been exposing the illegal activities of the POGO hubs. But then again, you're filing cases, but are you satisfied with the breadth and the depth, essentially? I mean, these cases, for example, you have Mayor Alice Goh. The Senate's determined she's actually not Filipino, but she's completely Chinese, so she shouldn't be sitting as a public official. But that's one issue. But the cases that you are filing against the Bamban Hub, the Porak Hub, are you satisfied?
Not yet, Karen. In fact, there are other cases that would be filed eventually against the incorporators, officers, and beneficial owners of Bamban and Porak. As to are we satisfied? Not yet. We're taking it one case at a time. We filed one major case. So we're hoping and expecting the OSG to file the co-warranto case against the mayor. Likewise, the OSG to finally cancel her birth certificate, her spurious birth certificate. Likewise, we're waiting for the Anti-Money Laundering Council to file the necessary money laundering case against her. So a good number of cases will be filed against Gu Waping and the other incorporators and beneficial owners of these bogus scam hubs. Now, bear in mind, Karen, a major component of these operations are in relation to scamming. So we'd have to finish the digital forensic examinations of all of the digital devices that you would present as evidence in court. Mm. Once we do that, we would be able to file the necessary cases in relation to violations of the Securities and Regulation Code, Consumer Protection Act, and other investment scam-related cases.
Okay. All right. Now, I think within the week, what are you planning? What is PAOK planning this week?
This afternoon, if I'm not mistaken, this afternoon or tomorrow morning, we'll be able to file the initial cases of kidnapping and serious illegal detention against some perpetrators of PORAC, of the PORAC scam farm. Remember, Karen,
but you haven't found them. You're filing cases.
They are.
Okay.
They are. Two of the perpetrators are in our custody. A good number of the persons of interest in relation to PORAC are with us. So we're developing, we're doing case build up against them. But you are correct. You are correct, Karen. A good number of the big bosses are still out there, but we're catching them one at a time.
All right. Now, my last question, I want to add this. I don't know exactly what the law is in China, but I know gambling is illegal. I don't know if it's life imprisonment or the death penalty, but what are the rules? Let's say, so clearly you've arrested Chinese nationals without papers who are involved in gambling, which China finds illegal, by the way. Pogo is illegal in China. What has the Department of Foreign Affairs said? Are we mandated to deport them and they be tried and heard there? Or are they tried here and they are, if found guilty, kept here?
Okay. Those foreign nationals with whom we have criminal evidence to charge them criminally, we charge them here. We've charged a good number of them already here. In most of the in all of these scam farms that we've raided, we've kept a good number of the foreign nationals here, and a good number of them are locked in jail. Now, the rest on whom we could not file criminal charges due to lack of material time or due to lack of evidence on hand, they're deported in China. But once they're deported in China, they're received by their police there and they're incarcerated. Most, if not, a good number of all of those that we have reported since September of last year are still in jail in China.
Okay. On that note, I want to thank you for joining me today. As always, sir, you have a good and, I guess, productive week ahead. Thank you so much. PAOK spokesperson Winston Casio. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Karen.